Hello everyone, Manoj Dineshok from Genetics Department, Agarkar Research Institute, Pune. I do research in wheat induced quality. Today I will speak the wheat grain that provides our daily bread, specifically quality or induced quality. In this video, I will talk more on importance of wheat as a source of food security, gluten protein, whether gluten protein puzzle is solved or still it is in the direction of complete solving. Wheat quality evaluation methods, what are those, why we read protein content, protein quality and quantity for wheat quality determination. As we know, wheat is a unique gift given by Mother Nature to human being, because around 17,000 years ago in Epipaleolithic period, its presence forced human being to evolve from shepherd hunter gatherer phase to farmer phase, and he started the agriculture. Wheat was domesticated around 15,000 years ago in the Fertile Crescent in Middle East. Cultivation of wild emmer and encorn started early in Neolithic period. Around 16,000 years ago, Neolithic man took several species of emmer and deployed encorn wheat for cultivation. He cultivated free threshing wild tetraploid wheat and non-brittle emmer wheats also. Later on, near Caspian Sea, wild tetraploid wheat and growth grass naturally hybridize and they form a polyploid hexaploid bread wheat, and this bread wheat around 5000 years ago started its movement all over the world from Central Asia, that is Fertile Crescent. This slide shows origin of bread wheat. Here, Triticum muratu, which has AA genome, is naturally crossed with Aegilops peltoides, which contain BB genome, and they form this Triticum tergenum or Triticum dicocoides, which contains AAB genome, that is tetraploid wheat. And this tetraploid wheat again crossed with Triticum tauschei, that is goat grass, and contains D genome, and formed the present day Stem wheat, that is AABBDD, hexaploid bread wheat. This is a picture shows the wheat cultivation in ancient Egypt, how human started domestication of cattle and crops for their benefits, and that is known as agriculture. So wheat Triticum genus includes a wide range of species, but only two species are grown commercially to a large extent. Triticum esteum, which is commonly known as common wheat or bread wheat, generally hexaploid and contains A, B and D genome. Triticum durum macaroni or durum wheat, genetically tetraploid and contains A and B genome. Over 90% of wheat grown worldwide is Triticum esteum, and it is used for a wide range of products including bread, cakes, pastries, biscuits, pudding, thickener and noodles. Triticum durum is mainly used for pasta production, and in addition, small amounts of a few specialty wheats are grown, such as spelt wheat and dicocum wheat. Wheat is unique because it is one of the most important crops worldwide. Its total annual production is 770 million metric tons on an area of 215 million hectares. In more than 90 countries, it is grown. It is staple food for more than 35% of world population, provides 20% calories, daily calories. In world economy, the role of wheat production is significant, both in terms of cultivated land and food supply. Polyploid nature gives adaptability, more diverse area than any other crop. Presence of gluten also gives the array of uses such as bread, biscuit, noodles and pasta. This slide shows the daily calorie intake from wheat for different countries. Mainly the wheat grain is divided into three parts. First is embryo, which is 3%, and large part is endosperm, that is starchy endosperm, but it also contains 12 to 15% protein, and the cover, which is called as a bran or aleuron, it is 10 to 13%. This germ contains vitamin E and B vitamins, while starchy endosperm contains gluten proteins, cladines and glutenins. Starch contains amylose and amylopectin. This slide shows different wheat uses, wheat products such as bread, noodles, pasta, macaroni, then biscuits and cakes. So basically protein grain, wheat grain is classified into its based on its physical nature, such as hard wheat, soft wheat or medium hard or soft wheat. And the classification is also based on protein content. If higher protein content, hard wheat is present, then that is good for specialty breads or white pan bread. If the grain, wheat grain, contains less protein, that is around 7 to 9%, and if grains are physically soft grains, then those type of wheats were used for biscuits, crackers and pastry. Gluten strength, it can be measured using different chemical tests such as SDS sedimentation volume, swelling index of glutenins, and also rheological instruments such as mixograph, alveograph, extensograph and farinograph. Wheat is unique because it contains a unique polymer in nature which has a combination of viscosity and elasticity, due to which array of food products were prepared. Gluten content depends on gluten quality, gluten protein quality and also its quantity. Gluten protein quality can be measured by doing electrophoresis of glutenins and gliadins. So at the end of 19th century, we know now glutenin gives elasticity and gliadins give viscosity to gluten. The science of breeding and selecting wheat for gluten quality was greatly advanced with the help of proteomics, genomics and agricultural modern practices. Gluten still poses challenges because of its complex and varied constituents. This is separation of gliadins using acid polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, and this is separation of SBS phage glutenins using SBS phage. These are high molecular weight glutenins, these are low molecular weight glutenins, and these gliadins are alpha gliadins, beta, gamma and omega gliadins. Gluten content can be measured using different rheological instruments, and generally if higher gluten strength wheat is there, then that is good for bread making and noodle making. If wheat contains medium gluten strength, then that is good for chapati making, pizza making or flat bread making. If durum wheat contains good gluten strength, higher gluten strength, then that is used for pasta making. So this slide shows the wheat flour mixing curves using different rheological instruments such as farinograph. These two are mixograph and alveograph. Here, the left side panel, all these three are from wheat gluten weak gluten flours, and these three are strong gluten flours. So if we want to prepare good bread, then we want the flour with balanced glutenin and gliadin. So the balanced glutenin gliadin flour shows this type of mixograph and extensograph curves, and bread will give you higher loaf volume. But if gliadins are more, then bread will be dense, the crumb will be denser, and loaf volume will be smaller. And if glutenins are more, then there is no softness, only elastic chewy type of bread will be prepared. So for best bread, the flour should contain balanced glutenin and gliadin. Starch also is important because it also has maximum share in endosperm protein, around 78 to 80%. So starch is again divided into amylose, unbranched polymer, and amylopectin as a branched polymer. And these amylose and amylopectin can be estimated using chemical tests, and this viscosity or starch properties we can estimate using a rapid viscoanalysis analyzer, which is a stirring rheometer that measures apparent viscosity of starch containing suspensions and flour water mixtures under variable and controlled heating, cooling and shear stress conditions. So this RVA gives peak viscosity, then holding strength, fasting temperature and final viscosity. So based on these RVA curve, we can estimate how much amylose is present and whether that flour is good for bread making or noodle making. Finally, conclusion, the future of wheat improvement may involve the more precise varietal development for specific end use, like for bread, for noodles or biscuits, more precise and quick and micro testing methods for bread, biscuit and pasta evaluations, good quality evaluations by combining phenotyping and genotyping methods, more studies on end-use quality so that tasty, nutritious wheat varieties were produced. Finally, I want to thank Director Agarkar Research Institute and also thank you all for your patient hearing or watching. If you have any questions, please email me mdoak@ari.org. Thank you.